My name is Michael Craycraft. I am the president of Greenworks Inspections and Engineering. So we are currently the largest inspection company in the state of Texas. I have 50 inspectors in the field, home inspectors. We have 5 in training currently, and then we have 5 currently looking to add a couple more for our April training. So we'll be between 60 and 65 inspectors by the end of April. So pretty large company, continuing to grow as well. And that's kind of a little bit of what I want to talk about, of why we're being successful, why we can continue to add to our team, even in this time where the market's a little bit down as far as the real estate transactions go. So I became a home inspector 10 years ago, 2014. I've done close to about 5,000 inspections, and there's a long story there, but what I found out pretty early on was that, and some of you may know this, was that there's a high season, a low season in real estate inspections. And I didn't like that too much because I needed a full-time job. The majority of my inspectors are the same. They also need that full-time deal where they don't want to go get another job in the winter. So that was my main focus of how could I fix that. And I found out pretty early on that if I can create my own pipeline of realtors and clients that would share my name, I could stay busy, you know, even working for a company that obviously, you know, answers the phones and does all the marketing and does all the business development side of things. I can take some of that and really kind of create my own path. So that's what I kind of want to share today is we're not going to talk so much about the inspection itself. You know, we can sit here and talk about water heaters for an hour if you want, but what I really want to focus on is the other side is how do you take that information and you deliver that in a way where you're not killing the deal and you're not scaring people and that you get your name shared through agents, clients, all the things, right? So there's two main things I want to focus on is one, the mindset behind that and what that mindset has to be. What I typically see in home inspections or home inspectors' mindsets, and then how it really has to change in order to really be successful. And then on the other side is, well, how do you do that? You know, what does that look like? And I will provide a framework in this webinar too of what we teach our inspectors and why they're successful and why they can go out really early on. I can take a brand new home inspector, teach them these processes, and within a couple months, they can be in a place where they are delivering the same level of service as if someone has been doing it for years. So I want to kind of focus on those two things. And again, if you're just jumping on, we are, the chat is open. So throw some questions in there and I'll answer those as I go. So number one, mindset. So what I typically see with mindset from a home inspector is, and if you go and you look on many of the Facebook groups and inspector chats and all these things, there's always a lot of complaints about clients, builders, agents. But the fact really is that we work for them, you know, and they are giving us work. So, you know, there is some control there that we would like to have, but the fact is they have, it's their purchase, it's their sale. So we have to kind of fit into what that looks like for them, not for us. So if you're a home inspector and your goal is to just make a couple $100 that day, that's good for that day. But what about the next day and the next day and the next week and the next month? How do you build your business so that you are constantly stacking all those inspections? So why I got into the inspection industry is I wanted to be in someone else's largest purchase that they'll probably ever make in their life, you know, a home buying purchase. So it wasn't about me, it's about them. So what, again, what I learned early on is that I can't just go in and say, hey, here's your list of things that are wrong. Good luck. See you later. But tell your friends about me. Right. And that's kind of where the industry was 10 years ago. But how we grew our business and what the things that we had to change were, we had to listen to what the clients were wanting, and what they were really wanting was a little bit more, a little bit closer to more of a consultant of, hey, here's this information, but what do I do with it? What does it mean? And you know, how do I get it fixed? How do I, you know, what do I do basically? So, that's really the mindset that us as inspectors have to have. And what I train my inspectors is, you know, what is our job as a home inspector? And our job is not to just tell you what's wrong with the house. Our job as a home inspector is to really let the client know what they're getting. So what are you purchasing? And that's good and bad things. So we have to balance, and we can't just say, here's all the bad things that are listed that I found. And then again, good luck. See you later. So really when you come out of the home inspection school, or really when you get into it, there is the kind of these guardrails that we have that are unspoken, but they're there. And on one side we have, well, don't kill the deal, right? And we you know, really try to stay away from that guardrail, but don't kill the deal, because then you're gonna upset the clients, you're gonna upset the realtors, all things. But then on the other side of the road, we have but tell them everything that you found, right? So don't kill the deal, tell them everything that you found. Well, if you think about it, those things are very contradictory, because if I tell you all the bad things that I found, I'm kind of killing the deal a little bit, right? Because it's going to sound really bad. And as if you're a home inspector on this call, you know that you can make any house kind of feel like it's falling over, and that it's, you know, even a brand new house, we can make it sound extremely horrible just by the language that we use. So, but how do we stay in the middle of the road? We don't bounce off these guardrails. So what I typically see from a home inspector is, we're gonna be over here on this side of the road, and I'm just gonna start telling you all the bad things about this house. And so we're bouncing off this guardrail over here. So then we're like, oh no, we're bouncing off this guardrail. So what do we typically do? We overcorrect. So we steer to the other side and we throw out things like, well, the house is in really good shape and the builder did a really good job. And I've heard this one quite a few times. This is the diamond in the rough. It's really a really nice house. It's a gem, you know, but then we steer back to the other side and we hit this other guardrail of, oh, but I still have to tell you all the bad things about it. And then we go bad, 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 bad again. Right. And it's really what realtors hate about home inspectors is that we constantly have to tell you that information, but the way that we present it is just like, this house is so negative. And then we scare the client and then they don't want to talk to us. Right. So how do you stay in between and how do you continue to add value? Because really what we're doing as an inspector is we're delivering bad news on someone's dream house. If we're just going bad, bad, bad. Right. So how do you still deliver all that information that we're supposed to deliver in a way that is digestible and it's non-scary is really what we want to kind of talk about today. So the method that we use, it's kind of a three-part method. Before I go into that, so definitely, again, use the chat, please. If you guys have any questions on mindset, we can go into that a little bit further so we can go back if we need to. But really, it's a three-part kind of a deal. So depending on what state you're in, we're in Texas, so we have pretty pretty high levels of training that we have to go through and all the things. And we have a certain template that we have to use. And I know InterNACHI has some of their own, but we have a state template that we have to use. And you can add things to it, but you can't take anything out of the original copy. So, but what we do is, one, we have to start, we start at the top of the report and we just kind of go through the report with them. So what I typically see from home inspectors and training them is, I'm just going to tell you the major things, and then I'm going to get out of there. So that it's really this really hands-off vibe of, hey, I just want to get out of here as quickly as possible because I don't want the liability and I want to just give you this information. But what we do and what we train is we hit every section of the report, even if there's nothing wrong with it, because we want to add the value to our service, not so much the house, because we're not trying to sell the house. And that is, trying to sell the house is kind of something that happens when we are hitting this left side guardrail of, I don't want to kill the deal. So we start trying to oversell the house. Well, this thing was so good about the house. And wow, that's a really cool feature. You know, we kind of start throwing these things out there. We want to hit every section of the report. And in every section, we want to answer three things, or not answer three things, but talk about three things. Number one, here's what the inspection entailed. Here's what I'm looking for as the inspector. And what that does is it does a couple things. It sets the baseline of what a home inspection actually is. So for the foundation's at the top of the Texas report. So here's how I inspected the foundation today. Now, I do want to throw this out there. This is completely separate from the inspection. So you have your inspection routine, which most of you probably have. And that's what they really harp on, is here's how you do the inspection. You know, go this way, loop around the house three times or whatever your routine is. But there's never a discussion on, well, how do I deliver that information? So this framework that we're talking about here is, this is kind of your routine to the inspection. Because I would argue that delivering that information to the client or the realtor is the more important part than doing the inspection at a high level. Also, if it, depending on your perception, in my belief is that if you could have the most amount of knowledge in the world on a house and how it's built and the things that are wrong with it and the things that are good about it, but if you cannot articulate that to someone else, to your client, to your realtor, the people that are involved in purchasing that house, you're not that good of an inspector, because that is part of the job that I believe we don't talk about that much. So the first part, kind of going back to this framework. So the first part is, here's what I did for you. So for a foundation inspection, we're looking, you know, from a visual standpoint, looking for signs of structural movement. We're looking for, you know, cracks over the doors, over the windows, through the bricks, you know, diagonal stair step cracking, all the things that we're looking for from a visual standpoint. This is also your opportunity to talk about all the little, like little joint separations that a lot of clients care about, that we don't really care about, that we decide not to say because we don't care about them, but the client cares about them. So this is a very proactive approach of providing information, so that my intent is trying to alleviate questions, and really give the client a peace of mind about this house, that I was able to look at everything. So, you know, that first part is, here's all the things that I'm looking for. The other way to approach, kind of look at that is, and you can kind of reframe it this way, here's all the things that I did for you. So I see a lot too of home inspectors start their walkthrough or their summary with, here's all the things I don't do during a home inspection. and they just list all the things. Well, if you think about it, there's kind of a lot of things we don't look at. But you're setting what you're doing at that is you're setting off the tone of here's what you're not getting instead of here's what you are getting. So if you flip that around and say, hey, here's all the things that I'm providing for you today, that is their focus. So you can have a negative focus or a positive focus. Negative focus would be, well, here's what I'm not getting. And there's plenty of evidence to support that, especially if I tell you all the, those things of evidence. Or I can get your focus to be positive. Here's what I am getting. And that's how we want to start this, summary is I want it to be on a positive thing or a positive note to where they're like, oh my goodness, I'm getting all that. Okay, cool. I didn't even think about any of that stuff. And that's really the mindset shift that we're trying to control. So here's all the things I'm looking at. And then step two of that is here's what I found. So now I'm telling you the things that I found. So here's why I have to tell you what I did first. So if I tell you, let's take the foundation for example. So I'm looking for cracks in the walls, cracks in the brick, doors not operating properly, windows sticking, the floors being out of level. I'm looking for all these things. So now as a client, I know what bad could be. So what I'm doing as the home inspector is I'm allowing you to compare. So, okay, now you've told me all these things you're looking for. And now I know what bad really could be. So, wow, if I had cracks in the brick, cracks in the walls, floors out of level, windows sticking, if I had all those things, wow, the foundation would be really bad. Now, when I deliver the second part of here's what I found today, it doesn't sound as bad unless it obviously matches, right? Which is, we'll talk about that in a second too. It doesn't sound as bad because now I have something to compare it to. So what we find as a home inspector is a lot of when we deliver information, then we start backpedaling on how bad it actually is. And, oh, it can be fixed. And that's when the realtor jumps in and is like, I got a guy that can fix that. You know, and then it gets back and it, this back and forth of like, well, is it bad? Is it good? I don't really know because they don't have anything to compare it to. And as inspectors, what we tend to do is we talk at a level as if we're talking to another home inspector. So like if you tell me there's some exposed post-tension cables or, you know, there's underexposure of the foundation or there's some corner pops or things like that, I know that stuff's not that bad. But a client who's buying a house that doesn't know anything, they don't know. Like, it sounds really bad. So we have to give them something to compare it to. So, hey, here's all the things that I'm looking for. And then here's a couple of things that I found. So now that without me having to overcorrect this road analogy, overcorrect to this other side and be like, but the house is in really good shape, because that's extremely contradictory. And what I see a lot is that the inspector will contradict themselves because they're trying to save the and not kill the deal. So hopefully that this is landing and making some sense. So now as the client, I have something to compare things to. And I'm saying, oh, well, that's not that bad. Now I go into step three, which is what to do with that information. So what is what's the solution or education? So if it's something that really doesn't need to be addressed, because as we know, as inspectors too, there's a lot of things that if the house is 20 years old that are just going to be there because the house is 20 years old or older, right? We know that at a certain age of a house, you're going to find a certain number of things just because houses change, right? So now we can have that conversation. It allows the space for us to explain these things. And then, hey, this does need to be fixed. You need to have this person come in and fix that. Or for a new, like we're doing a ton of new construction right now in North Texas. So, you know, a lot of that is like, especially with the foundation, there's not anything, it's a new house. So it's in pretty good shape, right? But that still gives us a space to plant some seeds. So I call it seed planting. So I can plant negative seeds or I can plant positive seeds. For my education, I want to plant positive seeds, which are things like, well, here's what you're welcome to homeownership. Here's what you're going to experience when you live here. So if you start seeing some of these things, this could be the indication. Here's what you would do about that. So we're educating, doing a ton of education on how to live in a house, how to, you know, what to do if you see things, not to be worried about that. Now, that does a couple things too. One, when the kind of the unspoken truth about home ownership is if I see something and I just bought the house and I didn't know about it, I want to blame the home inspector, right? And we want to try to avoid that. So if I can speak to that thing that's going to happen in the house or things that they will typically see when it happens, it's going to trigger them to be like, oh man, my home inspector told me about that. Dang it. Okay, that's normal. Or, oh, I need to call this person. So I'm planting that future seed so that they're not coming back to the home inspector being like, hey, I think you missed this, which is the tendency if I don't tell you. So that is the framework. So those three steps. Now, what we do is we do those in every section of the report. So in Texas, it goes foundation, grading, roofing, attic, exterior. So every section, I'm hitting those things. So think just a couple things to think about there. So all of the information that I'm giving you, so home inspection is 3 to 3.5 hours, let's say. Many times, let's say take a new construction. You're at a new construction house for, let's say, 3 hours. The client comes in and they're like, man, okay, we do the walkthrough. I give you, I don't know, 10, maybe 10 things from a new construction property, realistically. Half of them, they may have already noticed because they've been walking around the house for months. So I was at a house for 3 hours and I gave you 5 to 10 things. Some of you already knew about, like, what value is in that? And the answer is really none. There's not that much value there, you know? So, you know, I just paid you $500 for this home inspection and you told me 10 things, five of which I already knew about. Like, is that worth it? I don't really feel like it's worth it. Right. So what that does is it drives the price down for home inspections because we're not adding enough value, you know, and we have inspectors out there that I see their posts all the time. You know, they want to charge $800 for a home inspection, but then this is the type of value that they're giving is they're saying, hey, here's your report. See you later. Thanks for the $800. That kind of stuff drives the price way down. And those inspectors, it's hard for them to stay busy and people don't want to pay that because that's the expectation. So think about what I want you to think about and take from this is what kind of value are you adding to your actual home inspection and dirt, not the home inspection itself? Cause I would venture to say that the majority of people on this call have really good actual inspections. You probably find everything. You probably, you know, put it in the report, all those things, but how are you conveying that information to the client? So our goal is, okay, you know, you tell me 10 things that you were here for 3 hours. What were you doing for 3 hours? So I know that going in, my inspectors know that going in, they know that they have to change that mindset. So we want to change it from what were you doing for 3 hours? And if I'm hitting all these steps and I'm telling you all the things that I did, even if they are in good shape, I'm telling you all the things that you got from my service, which is increasing the value. Now it goes from what were you doing for 3 hours to, oh my goodness, you did all that stuff in 3 hours. It's like, do you need more time? Like, that's where we want our client's mindset to be, because now they have no problem paying more money or giving us $500 or $800 or whatever you want to charge if the value is there. So in today's industry, you know, especially real estate, people watch their money. Like, they want value for whatever they're paying. And if they don't see it, they don't want to pay it. So you have to really ask yourself, what kind of value are you providing to your clients outside of a standard baseline inspection. Now it could be more services. It could be, you know, like we have a ton of different services that we do, sewer lines. We do have engineers on staff. You know, we have pest control guys on staff. We have environmental consultants, all those things. So if you're doing that thing, yeah, it increases the value a little bit, but you still run into how am I conveying that information to where they're understanding it. And then they're feeling that value. So another thing that you want to think about is how am I leaving that client? So if I just give them, you know, a bare level inspection versus, you know, if I give them all this value, how are they leaving? So something to think about is every person that buys a house, when they leave the home inspection, if their realtor is there, obviously they know, but their realtor is going to ask them, their friends are going to ask them, their family is going to ask them. Everybody knows they're buying a house. They're going to ask, well, how'd the inspection go? And of course, you're going to be like, did it pass or fail the inspection? Which we know is not accurate information, but, you know, because it doesn't pass or fail, but that's the question that they're going to get. And what is their response? Like how are they going to respond to that question? Is it going to be, yeah, I guess everything went fine. It wasn't that much. It was good. I think we're going to move forward. Or is it going to be like, holy crap, is like, if you need an inspection, like you need to hire Michael. Like that dude told me so much information about my house. I didn't even know existed in the house. Like, which person do you want to be? Do you want to be the holy shit inspector? Or do you want to be the me? Yeah, it was okay, I guess. So some things to think about there is, how are you leaving? Like, I literally just got an email 2 weeks ago from a client that I did an inspection for 6 years ago, 2018. And they were like, hey, we're buying another house, looking to, you know, get a new inspection. Like, are you still in the industry? Would love to use you. 6 years later. So think about that amount of value that you have to add to someone's life who you met for maybe 45 minutes for them to remember you 6 years later. So that's the kind of stuff that we're talking about is, yes, they may tell their friend about you and you may get one or two inspections, but how do they remember you years later? How do you stay in the conversation years later when you've never met them more than once for less than an hour for the walkthrough? So kind of back to the framework a little bit is, so just to kind of recap that, if you're taking notes, so here's all the things that I did for you. Here's the things that I found. And then here's the solution/education. So you're going to hit every single section. Now, the first question that typically comes to mind when I'm training this, or when you're hearing this, is, wow, I'm going to be there forever explaining all that. That is one perspective, but think about the other side of this. So let's say I do a walkthrough and I am giving you the top five things at the house. And you, like, let's say it's a new construction, because this is a perfect example. I tell you, yeah, everything, I mean, foundation's good, you know, plumbing's good, electrical's good. Yeah, HVAC is, you know, like they need to change the filter because of new construction. And yeah, everything's good. Oh, yeah, roof. I got up on the roof. It looked fine. It's new. Looks great. Like, what kind of value is in that? Not much. So then what happens from the client perspective? They want more. So if your clients are being like, well, did you see this over here? Did you see this over here? I know that is a pain point for many inspectors, and it is for mine too. don't get me wrong. But I know instantly if they're taking you all over the house, you did not give them enough. So they are wanting more. You have to remember, we're inserting ourselves into the largest purchase someone else is making. So if they're like, it's their journey, not ours. So you're in it. And if you're not providing impact or value in there, they either want you out or they want what they're expecting. And their expectation is that I want value. Like, I want a good inspection. I want to know what I'm getting. So if they're doing that and they're taking you all over the place, it's because one, they want more. And two, you didn't address any of those things. Even if I was with one of my new inspectors recently, we were going through this, and his response to that, hey, did you see this? Yeah, I got it in the report. Did you see this? Yeah, I got it in the report. Did you see that? He had everything already. He just chose not to address it because he didn't think it was that big of a deal, which, again, is probably true. It's really not that big of a deal, but it is to the client. So that client's perception of that home inspection was, I didn't get my value because I had to point all these things out to the inspector. I don't feel like the inspection was good enough. Well, the inspection was like it, all that stuff was already included, but they had to point it out. So they feel like they had to do the inspection. So with this approach, it's a very proactive approach. So it's very short and almost brush it under the rug type of vibe. If I'm like, yeah, I got that. Of course I got that. Yeah, I've got that. Of course I got, I feel very defensive, or I'm coming across very defensive. And I'm coming across like, I just want to get out of here rushed. And that, if you're sensing that, the client is sensing that also. So they're going to give you not a good review. If you're asking for a review, like, why would I give you a review for that kind of service, for that kind of value? So this approach is very proactive. My goal was, as I went through, before I even knew any of their questions, my goal was to answer all the questions. Now, there's a cheat code in there, right? Because you do enough inspections, you're going to know what the questions are. Like, they all ask the same questions. So if you can integrate those questions that you know are coming into your summary, into your walkthrough, that stuff is going to, the client's going to be like, oh, wow, I didn't even have to ask that. Okay, we'll mark that off the list. Oh, man, okay. Okay, didn't have to show them that. Cool. They're marking everything off the list, and their view of the inspection is, man, this guy is so thorough. Man, he saw everything. Okay, damn, gosh, darn, okay. Man, this guy's wow, okay, I got a good, like, they're moving towards, I got a really good inspection. So, but it's just me being proactive and telling you everything up front. So the other alternative to this, well, I just want to give the big five, kind of before I go into that. So if I'm alleviating all the questions, think about, okay, if I just do my shortened summary, but then I'm answering all the questions at the end, my time is still this. So if I do this type of summary where I'm taking out the question time and I'm giving them more information, the time is still this. So it just depends on whether it's broken up to where, okay, I'm talking, they're talking, or I'm talking and they're good. So it's the same amount of time. When you get into it, it's the same amount of time. So you're not adding any more time to the walkthrough. But I will say this also, with my inspectors, at least, I'm giving, like, if you're not doing a 30 to 45 minute walkthrough, your walkthrough is weak and it's not good enough. And that may sound kind of harsh, but the reality is that's what they want. So why are we not giving that to them? Because anything less than that, they feel rushed. They don't feel like their questions got answered. You have to get out to get to the next inspection to make your, you know, extra $100 or whatever you're paying yourself or paying your people. It's rushed and the client is feeling that. So we train this because I hold my inspectors to certain KPIs for reviews and requests. It's really unfair for me or for anyone to say, hey, you need to get this number of requests, this number of reviews, and not teach you actually how to do that. Because if you're giving a really short inspection summary and you ask for a review, if there's no value, it's like, why would I leave you a review? Like, they're going to tell you on site, yeah, I'm going to do that. So I get that feedback from my inspectors sometimes too, is I can't get a review. Like, they're just not, they're telling me on site that they're going to do it, but you know, like, it never shows up. I go out and I watch their walkthrough and I'm like, well, that's why. Like, you're not giving enough value. Your walkthrough was 10 minutes. So think about, if you got that service, would you leave a review? And if the answer is no, then you have to alter that. So, so you're not really adding a ton of time to the walkthrough. If you're doing a really short one and getting out of there, then you need to add some time anyways. But if you're walking around answering a ton of questions anyways, you're spending the same amount of time. So that's kind of usually the first question for that. If you're getting a ton of questions, I used to gamify it. Like I said, like, I, my goal was to answer all the questions before I knew the questions, so that when I got to the end and I said, hey, are there any questions? You're going to get some random off the wall stuff sometimes, but I succeeded if they were like, I have nothing. Like, you've gave me all the information. I am gotten to the fork in the road, right? Cause that's, again, that's really our goal too, is to get them to that fork in the road of not buy the house, buy the house, with as much information that they can make an educated decision, without being mad at the inspector for doing that, right? Because if we're bad, they're going to be mad at us, and we're pushing them towards this don't buy the house side of the road if we're just telling them all the bad things. If we're on the other side and we're like, wow, the house is in really good shape, there's a couple small things, but, you know, and then they move forward with the house, but then they find that these things that we tried to say were small are big. And then now they're mad at us for moving forward with the house. And I wouldn't, you know, I'm sure you've all heard it, right? I wouldn't have bought the house if I would have known that information, which may or may not be true. but were they in a place where they could really evaluate the information and make that decision? Or were we, by the way we were talking to them, pushing them one way or the other? So I see a lot of inspectors pushing them towards kind of that negative side of, yeah, don't buy the house, or they're on the complete opposite. So our goal is to stay right in the middle and get them to that fork with as much information. Now they can make a good decision and they feel good about it either way. I've had realtors tell me, hey, I really like the way you deliver that information, because, like, even if they choose to not do it, it's from an educated place, as opposed to, oh, well, this house just is horrible, you know, and I'm killing the deal that way, right? I've never had a realtor tell me, even if they chose to not buy the house, that it was my fault because I pushed them that way. So we do have to be really careful on how we deliver that information. And it's a balancing act, because we have to give them all the information, but also we have to, you know, again, not kill the deal, right? So kind of back to that framework too, another really good thing about this framework is that, so a lot of times, look, I'm not having to say things like, well, the house overall is in really good shape, because I see that too. The house is in really good shape, but then I'm like, bad, all these things that are incorrect and wrong or deficient. Well, which is it? Because you said it was in really good shape, but again, you just gave me all these things. So if I go section by section and I break it down and I compartmentalize that certain section for the client, now I'm not saying the house is in good shape. I'm saying, hey, this component, without me having to say, hey, it's in really good shape, this component is good with the house. This component needs some work. This component is good too. This component, so whatever is there, whatever needs work, I'm breaking it down so that they're not saying, well, you said this house was good. I'm not saying that. I'm saying this particular part, the bones of the house, is in really good shape. these other things needs some need to be addressed. So it breaks it down to where they can't, it's really difficult for a client or a realtor to take my words and kind of use them against me as the inspector. Because I'm, if I say, oh, this house is in really good shape, that's what they're going to remember. But if we're talking about, hey, if I'm comparing, here's what I'm looking for, here's what I found, oh, that's their own assumption. I'm not saying really anything other than I'm just information delivering. So, so again, I'm hitting all those sections. The other thing that we really run into a lot is I just want to talk about the major five things. And this is a this is something that really are you have to question. So are the major five things, so your plumbing, your roof, your foundation, your HVAC and your electrical, are those truly the main five things? You know, and the way that I've seen it is that those are the most expensive things to fix. There's safety hazards in there, all those things. But think about a new construction property. Are those the top five things? Because all those are going to be in really good shape for the most part, right? Like you may have some things in there, but for the most part, those things are fine. It's new. But the sprinkler system, the appliances, these things, those are just two examples. Those things are extremely expensive to fix. Like think about a house. How much money do you have in appliances in a house? I mean, depending on the house, it could be 1,000 up to 5,000. You know, it could be crazy amount, right? Yeah, Jonathan, and floors too, right? Like technically that's not part of the major five, you know, because it's a finished material, but that's what people care about. Like if you go to a new construction property, how many times do you get questions about the floors? You know, so being proactive and addressing, hey, this is what I looked at with the floors, here's what I found, they know, you know, that you've already looked at that for them. So, you know, because what I think may be important about the house or this industry or what the schools tell you to talk about may not be the reality. So if our belief of this is what we should talk about is not matching reality, let's say reality is over here, we have to adjust one of those to get to alignment. So think about how I have to adjust. What do I have to do to adjust reality? Well, I can't control someone else's thoughts. So if their reality is, well, the floors are important to me, I need to adjust my belief on what I need to deliver so that my service and the expectation of the client are the same. So it's really about adjusting that belief and questioning, you know, what I think that client may need or want to hear. But the reality is they want to know everything. So we just have to kind of get out of our own mindsets there. But that's what this framework also does, is it allows me to hit all those things. So even if it might not be important to me, again, it's not my purchase. So it's not my job to pick out what is important, what's not important. Everything's important because it's included in this house and in this home inspection. And that's kind of my answer to the question of like, well, would you buy this house? Well, and I can't really answer that question because what may be important to me might not be important to you. But I'm going to tell you everything, and then we can discuss, and I can help consult a little bit on what you want to talk a little bit more about. Like, oh, you have questions here. Let's talk about that a little bit more. So, but again, this I'm hitting those sections and I'm hitting all the information. So what's important to you, you're going to get. What's not important to you may not get. But the other thing I hear a lot is, well, it'll be in the report, just review the report. Well, if you've been in the industry for a little bit, like you kind of know they don't really read the reports that closely. You know, we provide really long reports in Texas, and there's a ton of information in there. They're not going to read it word for word. So my kind of back to the mindset a little bit. My goal is that if you don't hear it from me, you don't know about it. So you can then come back to me and say, you didn't tell me about this. Oh, shoot, I didn't. You're right. So I want to give as much information so that you cannot come back to me and say, you know, even though it's in the report, really relying on that report. The report is more for us as the inspectors. So if this goes to a different level, if this goes to, you know, court, or they want to sue or whatever, the report is what I'm liable for. So that's really more for us, right? The walkthrough and the summary is for them. So whatever we tell them during that, that interaction is what they know about the house. So kind of think, keep that in mind too, is, you know, am I giving enough information? Am I giving enough value? Am I elevating that service? You see here, I don't see any other questions. Is there anything else that you all have in there? Okay, I see a question. You see the value in purchasing the narrative comment libraries available for energy specific inspectors. Here's my personal take on that. I'm not saying it's good or bad. I remember when I was in school. Now this was again 10 years ago. they slid me a list and they said, "Don't use these words." Man, that's hard. That's a really hard thing to do, because then you end up leaving out information because I couldn't figure out another word or another way to say that. My advice on that is come up with your own, because here's the other thing is, I see this a lot, and I kind of mentioned this earlier. If I think that question was from Michael, right? Yeah, Michael, if you and I are talking and we're throwing out terms that we understand as a home inspector, GFCI, TPR, you know, all these, you know, flashing, all these things that the common person has, I think about, if I'm practicing this, I'm thinking about, okay, I'm talking to my 9-year-old. If I said that word, would they know what that means? And if the answer is no, then it's not good enough, because I'm assuming that most people know nothing about houses. And that's where I start. Now, if the evidence during the inspection shows me that they know a little bit more, okay, I can adjust on the fly. But if I start high and they're low, now I'm talking over their head, and they're, again, it decreases my value because they're not getting, I may be talking very effectively if I was talking to you, but if I'm talking over their head, they're not getting it. So my value is not there. So be careful with what, like, different narratives and different terms. You have to look at the terms and you have to put it in to, like, layman's terms, so that a 9-year-old can pick it up if you're talking to them. Hopefully that answers your question there. Let's see. Is there value in giving them a pad and paper to document what they are seeing? I think so. I used to have people that brought their own. I always kept one. I always kept a tape measure. If they want to measure something, I'd let them borrow stuff like that. I'm sure I've seen other inspectors do that. Sometimes we do, like, little gifts too, like, hey, here's a pad and paper. It's a gift from us. You know, of course it'll have whatever your company logo is on it. So they'll remember you, but yeah, that's a really good tool. Hey, I want you to take some notes today. Then we can, you know, summarize, you know, what that is. So that, I think there's some value in that. Anything that you can do that helps them remember you is going to increase your value. You know, I used to get calls quite a bit of, just because this was my approach. And the other thing is you want to lead with empathy. Like, you want to really, if you understand the home buying process, that increases your value. If you've bought a home, that increases your value. But the thing that I see a lot of people miss on is they don't talk about it. Just like if you and I are talking, James, and I'm like, hey, man, I went through that too when I bought a house. I used to do that quite a bit. I was like, hey, at my house, I have the same problem. And it's been that way for a long time. And, you know, so you can relate. So if they're like, oh, wow, even the home inspector's house is like that, that's normal. But where I see some inspectors get in trouble is they openly admit that they've never seen something before. And they're like, oh my gosh, yeah, that must be really bad, right? Well, think about a client perspective. I just met you and you're telling me you've never seen something before. So that gives me two things. I either one got the brand new inspector and I'm like, shoot, I got the brand new guy, man. Now they're questioning everything. So I talked earlier about positive seeds and negative seeds. That's going to be a negative seed because now that's going to grow into, man, I got the new guy. Man, what else is he missing? What am I getting into? And what did I just do? I may have killed the deal. Or that thing must be so bad that the home inspector doesn't know what it is. This house is a piece of crap, right? So you have to be really careful about what you say and what terms you use. And you're like, oh yeah, I've never seen that before. Like I tell my inspector, don't say that. Like, look it up. You know, now that's the benefit of working for a multi-inspector firm is that person can send a message and say, hey, you know, what is this? And then we can coach him like in the process of, hey, here's what you say about that. Here's what this is. It's really not that bad. It's kind of normal. So we can do that on the fly. But if you don't have that access, I would suggest definitely, like if you have your phone on you, look it up real quick. Hey, what is this? Okay. Like, here's what I say about that. But be very careful about planting kind of those negative seeds of, oh yeah, I've never seen that before, because it's going to grow into something that you probably don't want. Right. But again, back to your question, I do think, yeah, giving them anything, with your company logo on it is going to keep you in front of them. But just remember the terms you use and the words you say are going to have more impact, because that's what they'll remember. So any other questions before we go? I think that's a good stopping point. If there's
From Amanda, did you see that one?
Oh no, I didn't see that one.
Yep, she asked, is it beneficial to do a follow call to clients a day or two later to make sure they don't have additional questions or concerns?
Oh, wow. I didn't even see that. Sorry about that. So what I have my inspectors do, and again, kind of back to that mindset a little bit, should have talked about that earlier. Our inspection starts hours before, sometimes the night before, and then it ends later. So we have our inspectors send a text message or a call before they even leave their house to go towards the inspection. That does a couple things. One, if they canceled for some reason and we didn't catch it, it gives us the opportunity to catch that before they have to drive all the way there. But then two, it's just a higher level of service. So they already know you're on the way. Then you can ask what their concerns are and you can kind of get prepped. And also too, from an inspector standpoint, you can catch them before they leave the house so that they're not like in your pocket the whole time. You can set that expectation, because a lot of what we do is expectation management. So you can catch that. And then we do the inspection. We'll do the walkthrough after, when we're done with the report, we send them another text from the inspector that has just a little brief message in there that says something to the effect of, hey, your report is ready. It was a pleasure doing your service today. Here's my flow code. So we have what's called a flow code, which is basically a digital business card, but it also has a review link in there. And then it allows for them to leave a review. So we follow up that way, and it gives them the opportunity to ask any questions as well. But we don't do a follow up call. Now you could. It depends on how busy you are. Like my inspectors are two and a half inspections a day, every day. That they're working. So for them to do the follow-up call. Now we have had some discussions about, well, do we have someone from like our office call? We haven't really had the need to do it though. Again, if you're doing the walkthrough at a high enough level, there usually isn't a need for callbacks. If, and I tell my inspectors this, if you're getting a ton of callbacks, you're missing something, especially if it's now. I will say I've gotten calls like months later and they're just like, hey, just want your advice on this. You know, I know this wasn't part of the inspection, but you know, we're thinking about doing this. What are you like? That's putting yourself out there as, you know, kind of more of a consultant as opposed to just the home inspector. So throw that out there. Hey, I have my inspectors tell them anytime you need anything, give us a call. We open that door wide open. We leave it open for sure. Sorry, is there any other questions I missed? I did not see them.
I think you got them.
Cool. Well, it's been great. If anybody has any follow-up questions, I'll post my email in the chat. If anybody has any questions, you want to send me an email, feel free to do so. I would love to chat or go back and forth with you.